registrar my boss, my personal friend, I want him to be not happy. And I celebrate you. I tell you, this is a very big privilege and a big opportunity. I repeat, it's a very big privilege to be called into this place, the house of Allah, to come and give lectures to my colleagues from the Muslim community. I say it because this is a show of love. This has translated to the world that we are one. Although some of our leaders have decided to divide us, but this pure love you showed by inviting me here has told me that that love that God reaches is really abundant here. And I will tend that to be the platform. I pray God that Allah will continue to show us love and to show love to our members, even beyond our people. Allah bless us. We've lost 15 minutes already. And we will see the best we can do because we must have here by one to catch up with time. So the manuals on it, because most of us are in academic environment, I'm already leaving the manuals with the training committee so that you can have a look in case what we didn't talk much about, what we want to do at our own quiet time. So we have a simple outline. We're going to define occupational diseases, aka work-related diseases. We're going to, the history we won't dwell so much on, because that will take our time. We talk about the classification and relationship between the host, that is me and you, the hazard or the agent we come in contact with, and the first factor, the environment, that either allows or supports diseases to come. Then we'll talk about the commonest in the work-related diseases or occupational diseases around us. We mention some preventive and control measures, and we go home safely at the end of the day. Simply put, I ask a question when I'm back in this topic. How do you walk home after work? If you want to bend down to enter your car and somebody is supporting you to bend after work, what it means is that the West is not in alignment. If the registrar is coming behind me and taps me, and instead of turning to say, registrar, I'm turning like this. 360. With my body and my whole neck turned. What it means, the neck is not at peace with itself. If you just bring me a letter to sign my signature, Dr. Wuna, Dr. Kala is saying you sign this. And I say, where is my eyeglass? My eye is in big crisis. So you must have to evaluate how you come to work and how you walk home. How you walk home, the condition you leave the environment decides so much on what your job is doing for you. And why it is important is that if you look at the first picture there, that is golden, the picture says, for how long have you been working as a chicken feather? The doctor is asking. Because of the duration of this man in the chicken fattening department, he's almost looking like a chicken. And you know the truth, the chickens see this man as a chicken. If he enters the chicken poultry place, everyone might be quiet. But if you enter, the chicken will start making noise. What it means is that he has so much work to get that the chicken identifies him as their neighbor, as a brother. So they don't see him as threat and they don't see him as foreign. That is what happens in our work environment. Sometimes you carry as a word that you carry a drilling machine. It's as if you're collecting toothpick. And I'm an inspector, Dr. Wuna, I've come to inspect your place. If I want to lift it, drilling machine, the way you lifted it up, I wouldn't know the weight. So I can carry it and lose my shoulder. And that is what you just picked as if it's a toothpick. So what now I'm here to do is to tell you that because of the relationship, we try to do our work environment so friendly. We will lose touch of the fact that if this man really becomes a chicken, he's dangerous to him. Because what it means is that he cannot eat food. He has to pick things from the ground. So if your work environment confuses you so much so that you are aware that and you forget that you should bear your bubble before environmentally friendly with the tools you work with. I tell you the truth, you can win all the awards as a welder in BTI, basketball, or after retirement, as soon as you get home, you become blind. And because you are traveling home after your retirement, I tell you the truth, the crisis will be pushed to the villagers that they've taken your life. They directly completed your building and practice, they've taken your life. Something applies to people that work in the grinding industries. Welding and fabrication, most people say when you hear welding, you think it's only welding. Welding doesn't produce any noise per se. But if you're a grinder, if you're a blaster, the noise is somewhat permanently there. And why I'm here today is to preach to you that 2 minutes and 10 minutes off your office is better than remaining in the office permanently. Because as a grinder, as a blaster, even if you are not the one working and your office is within the environment where others are working, you are as deaf as they were when you do not leave office. What happens? The decibels that is produced from the sounds you hear as a blaster become so frequently on your ear that it's beyond the number of decibels meant for the normal audible ear. And when it happens persistently for a very long time, how does it start? It doesn't start with that blindness, deafness. It starts with the registrar talking to you and you're saying, "Number, what did you say?" And you think the registrar doesn't have a good voice. He has, it's you that doesn't have a good ear. You start reporting to maybe your mentor in the Muslim community that your wife no longer respects you. You'll be talking to her and she'll be doing another thing. You don't know you're not even talking well. Or she's talking to you, you're not hearing. And that provokes you most times. You now start speaking with a very high tone. Because you can hardly hear from people, you think people can hardly hear from you. So when you want to whisper something to your neighbor, you're shouting and the other neighbors are hearing. Because you've gone off conformity with what is normal and you're going the abnormal way. So do you want to bend in that posture? When they bring you water to bath, you need something to support it to elevate it. Because you can't even bend, what it means is there is a problem. And before we get to prevention and control measures, I want to tell you today that the fastest way to leave what occupational disease can do to you is to free yourself from the burden of the exposure from time to time. That is why a radiographer, a radiologist that works in a radiology department, after a particular time period, gets his radiographic machine acid that picks the number of rays he has been picking from time to time, just a particular time, he's giving off to be for like 2-3 months before he resumes work. That happens in the developed world. It doesn't happen here. Here we push you until you die, we call for your burial, and we'll bring another person to start working again. And what we tell us in the economic values and the situation we are running in this country, even when you hear that the person that was holding this position just died yesterday, somebody is ready to resume work. No matter the calamity, say all die and die. It's better we die looking for a job than being at home. That's what we do. So can we explain shortly what we mean when we say occupational diseases? Before we get into that, I must tell you that occupational diseases are not limited to the local workers. Our guy here that stays in a meeting 8 hours from morning till night talking. I visited him one on one, I visited the president one on one, and I told them 2-3 hours into a meeting, we start shutting down. Mental, that's the gospel truth. It's the way God created man. 5 hours into a meeting, we become almost unproductive. And that is why you see the arguments within our management team are worse towards the end of the meeting. Because nobody's thinking well at that time again. Nobody rationalizes well at that time. A comment that would have ended in 2 seconds would now be tracked. What do you mean? How can it be 8 o'clock? Let it be 8:05. What is the difference between 8:05 and 8:00? There are the things we spend time with because glucose has shut down in the bread. The bread is no longer doing the work to you. And within that 8 hours, it's possible that nobody has moved an inch. So status, you've been at a place, the heart is even getting tired because nothing is stimulating it. That is why no Western world will have a meeting for 2 hours without a break. It's not possible. Even for the trainees who go abroad, after every 12 hours, doctor can bear you with this. You be told to walk around, you greet each other, exercise. Those that want to take fresh air will take, and everybody comes back to normal. So, occupational diseases are not limited to elders. I have assisted 27 persons due to spinal cord injuries since I started my medical foundation. Majority are judges. And you know why? Because they sit down from one thing, right? Judging on one person's case. I tell you that a judge is the only person that I know that can hold a hearing for 8 hours. If a judge is to give a ruling and he starts being pressed, it doesn't work. And I don't know how they do it. They send message to the rest, then they pray. Forget this unit, you cannot go. Wait for 8 hours, okay, this judgment is over. That time you're poisoning your bladder. But you wouldn't do. The sentence is staying in one place, majority of them are hypertensive. And because you're sitting so much for a long time, your spine has been dormant without any exercise. Majority of them come down with lumbar canal sclerosis, which is a compression of the core, which does not allow them on immediately on retirement. They go on wheelchair. So if you don't go abroad or a wonderful center in Nigeria, you're here, they can replace all your spinal bones with nuts and bolts, you might never be able to work out again. And in Nigerian context, how much do you earn to do a surgery of 3-4-5 million? It's only by the grace of God because of where we go. But definitely I can bet you that I can count the number of persons among us that will keep 5 million down for when we're going to fix our spinal condition. That's why no matter what you get, when the chiefs are down, when days go by, you start begging for funds. Because you don't have the money to keep it something, you need to use it. And unfortunately for us in the country, whereby one person that is working is feeding 30 million persons. Before the money comes, it has finished. Myself, an example, my December salary is already gone. Just for it to come so that we give it to the owners and it's over. So are you a chief executive? Are you a head of department? Are you a plumber, a tax officer? There is always a risk that is associated with predisposing factor that brings you close to opportunities. And we are here now to introduce you to them, for you to know them, and for you to know how to stay away from them. Health has always been defined as a complete absence of disease. But the WHO said no. You might not have a disease in your body, but you're not healthy. I have a current staff of NNPC and mentoring them. The father takes nothing is wrong with him. But I told the father they want to come to see me. I said, your son is mentally having challenges. He said, how do you mean? I said, well, walking into my office, that 5 minutes, I saw him like he was depressed. And this is my 2 weeks of his therapy. And what have I found out? The young man is 32 and he has never taken a decision in the house. And he doesn't understand it. Because his best friend is Aiko Buda, who left my house at the age of 19 and runs things my way. So he's just trying to say, well, why? I'm working now, I'm married, I have 2 kids. But somebody will still have to direct me on what to do. Which kind of problems is that? He is looking healthy, but I tell you he's not. He's very, very sick. So WHO defined health as a state of complete physical, mental, social, and I just added, economic well-being of the person and not merely the absence of disease. Why did I add economy? All is well with you, no fever, no headache, no typhoid, no malaria, and you don't have a cobo in your purse, I tell you, you're worse than the person that has typhoid. Very, very worse than the person that has typhoid. So finally, let us define the word occupational disease. There are diseases that are contracted as a result of exposure. And whenever we say exposure, this exposure doesn't have to be one of them. Most times we use the word chronicity. It's always a chronic exposure to risk factors arising from our workplaces. In other words, you can equally say occupational diseases that are made worse because of the occupation. How do I mean? If I start coming to the clinic, I'll be okay. Anytime I start coming to the clinic, I'll be sick. Those are the ones who classify as occupational diseases. So what word is important here in our trying to expose what occupational disease means? Exposure. That's a key word. That's why it is written in capital letter. There must be an exposure to a risk factor which the environment supports or not supports for us to get to the disease. So I said we will not dwell so much on the history because that you can read up in time because of our time. But occupational diseases dated back to Middle Ages. We are back then, we are seen in Egyptians, working in mines. We are cancer was identified by pots, a London surgeon, who identified chimney sweepers, those that work in the chimney. The sweepers having scrotal cancers. They were seeing that the exposure of the carbon suits in the chamber was responsible. Can we do occupational diseases with forgotten lead poisoning? Asbestosis, those who are working with silicon and asbestos, pneumoconiosis, we cannot. You can read that up later and you know what will cause occupational disease. But in discussing occupational disease, we cannot do but give credence and honor to the international labor organization. Why? Because what they were looking at occupational disease when they started was compensation. That is our own Pegasus now. International labor organization was looking at, oh, doctor, when I finish this working in PTI and I contact HIV because I was treating HIV patients, what do you do to him? You just tell him bye-bye, you go there and go. No, there should be a package for exposing me to HIV patients and making me happy again. That is the early reason why occupational disease was being discussed by the international labor organization. At a time, 2004, they now said, come on, you mean we'll just be waiting for the corona to have HIV and give him a package to go? No, why don't we see that we take measures to make sure that all those that are exposed to particular needs do not even have the HIV? Can't we help Dr. Wona in the clinic such that there is a way he will work in the clinic and still go back home without having HIV? So international labor organization having worked on compensation, which is the main thing that made them start ILO those days 1925, now saw the need later in the 19th century that it will be important for us to waste our taxpayers' money in waiting for people to be sick first. We must do preventive measures. They are now brought in regulations as to one of the most urgent diseases why international labor organization dwells so much on occupational disease. So what are the regulations? They do inspections, they do monitoring, they do facility checks up and down to be sure that those factors that are responsible for us to get diseases are under control. That brings us to the fact that if you go for any safety training or safety exams before now, and everyone asks the question, what do you do for safety? Everybody rushes to PPE. That was what it was. Even in the 1980s, I'm not talking about 1980s, when we are young. But what do you do if you're working in a place there is dust? Everybody will say you use mask. If you answer that in international safety exams now, you'll be thrown to the back now. What do you do in a factory that produces dust? Those people that work on wood companies, that polish wood, and you see dust particles everywhere. The most effective is not protecting yourself from the dust. The most effective is there any way to produce a machine that when this dust is being moved from the wood up, the machine takes up the foods. Some people will call it mufflers. Some people will call it absorbents. Whatever terminology you give to it, what the white man and the black man is trying to invest on is that fume suckers, whatever will make sure that any little thing that would have been heard by Dr. Wenda doesn't even get up, not to talk of getting to me. So those fume suckers will make sure that all the dust particles are sucked away. But there comes a time, my brother, in my life and in your life, where these machines might not work 100% effective. There comes a time when even in the production of the machine, because we are in a world that needs marketing, they've marketed to you that it sucks 100% of the fuel, but it doesn't really suck. Maybe it sucks 95, which is only a pass mark. What happens to the 5%? They get to you. That is where your PPE comes in conflict. Those ones that the machine couldn't take care of, those ones that the absorbers couldn't take, the PPEs will be there to protect you at that time. So what of if the exposure is shocking? Assuming a particular carcinogen, a particular particle gives people cancer when you work in a place for 1 year stretch. And you now say, Dr. Kraye, please, I'm your boy. I cannot walk straight 1 year, because if I walk straight 1 year, I'm going to have the time. Why don't you allow me, if I work for 3 months, I'll go home for 1 month? How do you think what brought about the process will be in the oil and gas industry, just 2 months in, 2 months out? It is related to occupational diseases and the way forward. And that's why I'm getting the registrar. And I would like to work 1 month together so we can work much out. Later we discuss about that. So, Dr. Ogalaga. accidents are always sudden. You get to a welder, he mishandles his welding machine, he cuts himself. That's an occupational accident. He doesn't go for compensation because you didn't handle your tool very, very well. But the blaster guy uses a machine that vibrates when he is trying to sandblast. And when he is doing it, I tell you the truth, he works for 25 years and goes home. When he is with his wife, he's shaken when there is no machine. Because the body has been sensitized, the brain has been told, every 2 hours, please vibrate. If you don't, I will get angry. So the guy is home, retired. He's holding the wife, he's shaking the wife. Because the brain just thought that the wife is the sandblasting person. And before you know it, he starts shaking his wife. So if, I'm just putting an if, the frequency of occurrence of that requires Mr. A to work for 2 years straight before such a thing. If peradventure that disease can only occur because of the fact that you worked 2 years straight, any time you take off, which is the government, what the government has created for us, 32 working days, any time you take time off, you recuperate and come back fresher and better. The first one I said was on a lighter note, but thank God for the privileges the register has given us to be working in the safety and the security committee. Every time, I pray God, if we have good legislators, I am one of those that will move a legislative bill to see if we can change our leave from 32 working days to 16 working days divided into two. 32 working days divided into two. Why? If you work for 8 months straight and go for 32 working days in a good translates automatically to almost 6 weeks, your 8 months is gone. If you come back, you can only be productive the first 2-3 months again before our ministry return sets in again. That's the gospel truth. When I see the management say that we cannot split leave, I understand what they are trying to fight against is those of us that not earn salary, that receive salary. You know, some people earn salary, some people receive salary. Those that receive salary just wait for end of the month. They call, have they paid? They say yes. You go to the bank. But those that earn salary are those that their salary is linked to productivity. If I don't go to work for 1 week, I don't think Dr. Karaye will receive my call in good faith. But I know many of you that the boss is away, so the subordinate can be away, nothing happens. After the end of the month, salary will come. So if we can get to that level in this country, I know that with time, these are things that we can sit down and organize, question the pros and cons, and know whether it will be viable for us to be divided our leave. So that if you do 5 months, go for a 3 weeks break, you come back and do 5 months, go for the next 3 weeks break. And this is just by the side. But when the bill starts, I know so many of you support a bill that I can wonder what is. So can we discuss occupational disease without talking about the etiology, the process of occurrence, what a layman might call a causal factor, what is the relationship between our work, the environment, and the risk factors? That's what we're saying. It's a tripod relationship. You are the host, you are the worker. The agent is the hazard. Like in a lab, the reagents will work with it. And the environmental factor is that if you're working in a lab with a fume in a well-ventilated room, and another person is working with the same agents, but in a non-ventilated room, that person is more at risk than you are. So the environmental factor plays a very huge role. That the man that would have been sick because of the fumes is exposed to, just because the environment is conducive and clear, he might not fall sick. Why the other man, on touching those things for the one, becomes sick? How do I know? I understood the factory in New York. They produce popcorn. And their popcorn is one of the best. And their mixers are always falling ill. In the 70s, those that mix the coloring of the popcorn are always falling ill. They tested the chemicals and everything. Everything was looking rosy. But why are these people falling ill? And when they were falling ill, they were just falling ill with respiratory infection. So they brought in an occupational physician like me to understand the case. The guy Abigail went through all the processes of producing popcorn and now saw that the process of coloring popcorn